All right, so in the sake of time, let's, we're about 15 minutes past the hour, so let's get started. I'd like to call this meeting to order. I believe this, our roll call of our steering committee members will be the sign-in sheet that you were signing in. So first I want to just kind of welcome you all to our, I believe this is our fourth meeting this evening. I'm excited to be here. I want to kind of start out by talking about a few items that we will hit again at the end of our meeting today, because we have a lot to accomplish. But we want to start off with... Oh, yes, I'm so sorry. Hello, we have, I believe Sarah has called in, correct?
Sarah Beasley, Diane Duesterhoff, and...
Great, are you with us? Can you hear us?
Yeah, I'm here.
Hi, good evening. Thank you so much for joining us.
Wendell's here too.
Yeah, hi Wendell, thank you.
This is Jessica, I'm on the line as well.
Hi Jessica.
Can you hear me? This is Marjo.
Yes ma'am, we can hear you. Can you hear us?
Yes, I can, thank you.
Great, thank you. Okay, so let's, I just want to kind of follow up about some items from the last meeting that we had with Mayor Ron Nuremberg and Councilwoman Amy Sandoval. I think I wanted to follow up, you know, at that meeting we talked about some high level kind of, there was a lack of clarity over the process and kind of our expectations, so I kind of want to just start off with that. So the first thing, I think we have great news in that, and I'm just going to kind of hit a couple of these items quickly. The first great news is that we have an extended timeline now to April of 2019. Second is that we will be meeting, all steering committee committee meetings will be in person. There will be no more online meetings. I'm going to provide that clarity right now. You know, in terms of agenda items in the future, and we're going to talk about this in a second, but if you have any requests for something to be added onto the agenda, I just think so that we're very clear, if you will please send those requests to me and I can forward them to the city staff. I can act as chair of the collection agency for those suggestions. But I also want to talk about, another commitment that we have is that, now, it didn't happen today because we're trying to get some stuff together, but moving forward, you will receive all the meeting materials 3 days prior to the meeting. I think that's something that's very important, that we get those materials ahead of time in a reasonable manner. So in terms of clarity, there was an email that was sent out. I want to draw your attention to it. I want to kind of go over this very quickly. On the working group and steering committee overview. So there was these two documents, one that kind of referred to the overall, cap schedule. We've all kind of seen this chart before. I think that this is a little bit more straightforward, this list of what are the actual meeting goals, every single scheduled meeting for not only the working groups, but also the steering committee. So that we know what we were supposed to, what is the operational objective of each day. And I think that this is a very, very important document that can help provide us some clarity about what is supposed to be happening when. What is supposed to be happening when. And I hope that it is in an easy, straightforward presentation manner so that we can kind of get our heads around how the working groups, meeting outcomes and objectives should be aligned with the steering committee meeting outcomes and objectives. So the staff has put together a really nice, concise, clear list per day of every meeting between now and January the 9th of the working groups and the steering committee with our meeting outcomes. So I just wanted to draw your attention to this very important document because this tells you specifically what we need to be hitting to stay on pace at each meeting. And I think it's presented in the, even for myself, it's like easier to understand this than to understand this one. So I think it makes it very clear. And I will always say that to me, this is like my gold standard. I always want to go back to this document. If you want to know where are we in the process, what are we supposed to accomplish, this is what we are supposed to accomplish by date per meeting. the next thing I wanted to just kind of, and I'm sorry if I'm moving quickly again, we're going to talk about a lot of, you know, we can talk about these items later on in the agenda, but we have a lot to accomplish today during our meeting. I think, you know, we have some great points of discussion and some decisions that need to be made. We'll be reviewing everything from our getting a kind of an update of the technical working group to talking about the status of our kind of climate projections, talking about the greenhouse gas inventory, our greenhouse gas targets. So we have a lot to accomplish in this meeting, so I'm going to try to keep us on time. Now, that being said, Doug, I've asked Doug to take just a moment out. We have a lot of handouts that have been brought. I'd like to
so we're going to try to kill as many trees as possible. I think we just want to make sure you have the materials in front of you for reference. One of the things that we had heard was there's still some uncertainty about what we're doing, what the plan is going to look like. So I printed for each of you a copy of New York's 1.5 degree plan for your reference in terms of what they're trying to accomplish and in terms of some methodology issues. The one caveat with this is built upon many years of other climate planning work. But, you know, some of the things we like about it was how they address co-benefits, how they're looking at developing that target. So I'm going to hand this out. There's a couple other plans that are floating around. One is New Orleans' recent plan. One of the things that we like about that is it does a really good job about telling the story around why this is important. And then I'm also going to pass around Seattle's plan and, you know, simply highlighting a few sections. They're all fairly similar. It's a baseline of our emissions. It's identifying what the target is. It's breaking it down by different sectors and what are the strategies that are going to be implemented to meet those objectives. So just for a reference point. The other thing that's nice about Seattle, and I bookmark a piece with it, it shows how they address equity in each section. So, you know, for transportation, for example, they have three equity action items. So I think just pass them around, review them. There's a break, about a 30-minute break through the process. We'll see how we're doing on time. Any questions, let us know. But I think we just want to make sure you guys continually evolve as far as your understanding of what it is we're trying to accomplish.
Are these available electronically?
These are actually on all the Google Drive.
Let me ask a kind of a quick question here, because this has kind of come up before, which is why we brought them in person. If I can kind of just, from our steering committee, has everyone here had an opportunity to go on the Google Drive? And it's easy to use, and you find the materials there. I know that I can just speak personally. Several years ago, when we converted from a server to the Google Drive at Bill Santonio Green, I was the last person to figure out how to use it. So I just wanted to ask that question, if everyone has good access to it.
Yeah, I will say that I think some firewall system will allow you. If that work, I can.
Okay.
Yeah, if anybody's having a problem, just let us know. And we'll
let us know.
The government. I'm aware of this problem.
Okay.
It's happening all the time. People send us links to documents.
Okay, yeah, access is very important so that we all are able to access information. Great. Since we're running kind of behind, I would like to, at this time, we have a wonderful lineup of guests here, I see, that have joined us this evening, and want to open it up at this time, move to item number 2, which will be public comments. Yes, and so they needed to sign in, so I guess we'll proceed. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4. I think 5 people. I don't know if the first person if they were signing out or not, but we can start at this time. So
and ideally,
I think
please limit
to
2 minutes as best we can.
All right.
Who's the first one?
Well, I have to apologize that I cannot read the first person's name.
Maybe can I?
Who's the first person who signed up?
Go.
Who's the first person?
It starts with a K.
Mm-hmm.
Bert?
Number 2.
Any volunteer?
Oh, that's okay. I didn't know. Yeah. And so, a first step will be Meredith McGuire.
My name is Meredith McGuire. I'm on the Water and Natural Resources Committee. I would urge everybody here, including people who are involved in other ways in this process, it's really, really important that we not be unambitious. And I'm very concerned that the greenhouse gas inventory is starting out with the assumption that a whole lot of issues are not even going to be looked at or named or quantified. I urge you to have a much more comprehensive and much more disaggregated set of information. In particular, for example, when you're talking about big generalities like the amount of emissions per capita, then you're ending up generalizing over a population, but the generation of those emissions are not evenly spread among those per capita. And so I think that in addition to that overall number, we need really good disaggregated information. How much exactly is coming from industry? How much exactly is coming from the hospitality industry, for example? All of the different things that would make a difference in how you go about approaching reducing the emissions in that segment, we need that information now. And it doesn't mean that you necessarily have to build that whole detail into the plan, but knowing where those sources are, for example, suppose there's an industry that's itself already emitting a lot of greenhouse gases and is also using a lot of water and also using a lot of energy. There's some ways by which you might be able to address that issue with subtle, I won't say pressure, but I think that there are ways by which that industry could contribute to reducing the greenhouse gas emissions that they themselves are putting into the atmosphere. So, urge you to be very ambitious. Push hard.
Thank you. All right, we have Mr. Stewart.
Gordon,
I apologize.
Yes, good evening. My name is Stewart Sundama. I'm with Citizens Climate Lobby. And I want to talk about the greenhouse gas inventory. And I'd like to wait until we actually have that for the presentation. But my initial response would be redundant. I think that there are gaps that can be filled in with some careful diligent work, and it would be very difficult to have an effective plan without having a complete picture of your greenhouse gas emissions.
Thank you. Mr. Russell? Russell Seal?
Yeah,
oh,
camera.
Yeah.
Everybody knows.
You're so vain.
Face both live in the presentation today, and in case people didn't understand. I'm on the Energy and Buildings Committee, and most of the comments and stuff I will save for that committee. But what I have been, and others have been really digging into it, like I hope you all have. But one of the things, the borders, I hope you all discuss the borders. When we have for CPS energy emissions in the graph on that bar, we also need the corresponding transportation emissions to match the CPS energy territory. The reason is, in the document it says CPS Energy is going to deploy solutions outside of the city limits. Whatever they do for the inside, they're going to be doing for outside. Thank you, CPS Energy, for doing that. But if you don't have the inventory of the emissions from transportation, and one of our biggest things we're going to have to do is electrification of our transportation grid, we have to know the transportation numbers for outside the 1024. And the time frame to develop comments for the public, way too short.
Mr. Terry Burns.
We really need all of you
emissions related to it from the Eagle Ford that we're buying gas from, and in order to get good targets for emissions. And we need to be more aggressive in Paris because we already know we're shooting way past. We're going to be at 500 parts per million mid-century. And, you know, 350.org is way too late. We're already way too late. We have to really get extra high speed on this and be really extra ambitious to make a positive difference to our community.
Thank you. I have a very quick housekeeping item. Will our committee members that are on the phone, we have a little bit of feedback. If you might put your phone on mute. I'm worried about the feedback on Facebook Live. Thank you very much. All right, so, and I just want to say thank you very much to all of our, all the people that came here and took the time out to have a public comment over this process. It's very meaningful to me, and I think it's a very important, important thing, so thank you very much. Let's move to item number three, which will be our technical working group reports. I kind of wanted to launch off with this. You know, I have mentioned this a couple of times. It is no small thing to accept the position of...
Thank you.
It's no small thing to, one, to want to be a part and to accept a position on the steering committee, but it's an extra step to say, yes, you know, I want to be the liaison for the technical working groups. And so I want to start out by saying, you know, thank you so much for your service. I think it's a critical part of this body moving forward is that our liaisons coming and talking with us about what is happening in the technical working groups for the members here that are not able to attend all of the meetings. That's really what the liaisons are for. I think that, you know, each of these liaisons, you have all been selected because of your expertise and experience within that arena that that you are serving as liaison for. And so we're really, I know I'm definitely looking to you for some feedback and for discussion and for you to kind of kick off at these meetings and on the agenda moving forward the report from those working groups. And I think that that will become more important as we obviously are kind of getting started here down that path. So I just kind of wanted to kind of jump off with that. And this evening we've asked our technical working group liaisons to give a report about what is happening with each working group. I know that even though Sarah has joined us, I don't know that we were able to, we were not aware if she was going to be coming. I think Nils was prepared to kind of give her presentation, but moving forward, we'll be looking at the liaisons. It's a very important role that that you're serving and one that is extremely necessary for this process. So, and again, in the spirit of not being talked to, but us talking amongst ourselves and being engaged with these groups, it is pivotal to the success of this plan. With that being said, I'm going to call upon I'm going to call you our little captains out here, our apostles. I'm going to call on each one of you to kind of give us a rundown on what's happening in the technical working group, and we can discuss. The challenge is that we have a lot of big things to talk about this evening, so but we obviously don't want to skim over anything. So I think what we should do is, one, I'll call upon you, give you a report, try to do it concisely, you know, if you can, and then let's open up for, because I know we're going to have comments and some discussion, but y'all are going to have to help me out because I know it's going to be a challenging, so I'm sure we all have a lot to say. So with that being said, first step to that, right. Doctor.
I'll do it. Yep.
So Dr. Garcia serves as our liaison for the Waste and Consumption Technical Working Group. And so again, you know, we appreciate your service. And
sure.
I'm going to start with you.
I wanted to sort of mention a couple of items from the first time the group met. They, of course, had a nice meet and greet everybody. It's a group who is very much engaged and likes to sort of talk to everyone in the room, and no shy people in that group. They contribute and they're very focused. Something that came up during the conversations that they had, there were three items that I wanted to kind of bring to this group. One of them was how there was no viability, at least in that group. They were thinking through whether the idea of generating energy from waste was a viable option. You know, just taking waste and then can we generate energy? They had a healthy discussion about that and whether that was technically viable currently. They spent some time talking about the methane capture from landfills. That seemed to be very much of interest to that particular group. And then lastly, and this is the one that piqued my interest, just on a personal level, is that that group also talked about how HOAs HOA policies could be a problem for waste and for recycling and things like that. And I'll be honest with all of you, I never thought about that. I live up in the Chavano Park area of our community, and I mean, we get hammered by the HOA all the time about, you know, a lot of items, and certainly, I mean, I think waste and recycling, I think that was probably an important point that group made at that time. On their January 27th meeting of the Waste and Consumption Group, one of the things they agreed to do is not to have online, that online meetings would no longer take place. That group decided that they weren't going to do that. They did have a healthy discussion about if there was a possibility of the city ordinance banning plastic bags, and what was that, what happened to that, it was struck down, and the answer to that was that apparently they got confirmation from the city attorney's office that state law dictates that local governments cannot assess a fee or deposit on plastic bags. So that group is interested in this whole idea of, you know, what do we do with all the plastic bags that are out there. In the implementation plan discussion, they did talk a lot about, okay, so who's going to implement the cap? Who's responsible for that? Who's going to coordinate it? Who's in charge of it? And the answer is the Office of Sustainability. So, Doug, I guess it's on you. you're the man. Yeah. So, on the climate projections, the data that we all looked at on temperature increases, et cetera, the question that they raised had to do with what effect do the climate projections generally have on waste production and recycling? Like, what is the impact of that? And so the discussion around there was about, okay, look, if there is more waste being produced, then the hotter temperatures are going to result in a higher intensity of methane. And that was from landfills, and that was a discussion that was had. As far as the vision and priority survey that we all looked at, the survey by the public about what are they interested in, and that group felt like the initial results from that survey, that waste and recycling was not a high priority for any group. But, you know, we broke it down by age groups and ethnic groups. It wasn't on people's radar. So that group felt like maybe what they needed to do was find a way to make it a priority for people. And somebody suggested that perhaps they can tie waste and consumption to something that the respondents did care about, such as cleaner rivers and streams, and then just say, well, why don't we tie it to that, and then maybe people will pay more attention to recycling. As far as the co-benefits, they reviewed that brainstorming session that we generated on the co-benefits, and they agreed that if they wanted to submit other co-benefits from their working group, that they would then submit it to the steering committee. They would come to us and say, look, here's some co-benefits that waste and consumption came up with. They also wanted to extend that period on the GHG inventory in the public comments. They wanted more feedback on the implementation of co-benefits. So they have a deadline of July the 13th to sort of submit any more of those. And I'm going to say that they may submit them to you. I think they said you're the one.
Okay.
Either it's either you or maybe Lisa.
I think her slip was officially turned in Lisa, but I'm obviously not either. There's a couple of options.
Yeah, I think it was you and Lisa, and that, I don't know that they mentioned you, but they mentioned Lisa. Yeah.
And that's till the 18th. Dr. Garcia, that's till the 18th.
Was it? The 18th?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
And then their next meeting is July the 25th. If any of you want to attend, it's a Wednesday, 9 a.m. at the South Flores office in the main conference room. And something that came up that was interesting during comments was did anybody consider the impact on the projections on people that do not have access to air conditioning?
This is a great thing. I think it becomes very significant just hearing you give the first, this is our first report from the working groups, right? You see the importance of the liaison's role with the working group, and also in the communication with them, again, one of the things that we're here to do are, as a liaison, I say, great, this is what's supposed to be, this is our meeting objective for that next time. So again, there's that question, like, what are we doing?
Yeah.
We can say, well, for the working group, you have two objectives. One is the comprehensive list of mitigation strategies and the cost-benefit analysis within this range. And second is the input on the final GHG reduction target. So now they kind of understand, like, a framework. With that being said, let's open it up for discussion around that report.
And by the way, they punted the question about the AC to the Energy and Buildings Working Group. They said, yeah, you know, that's their wheelhouse. We'll let those guys work on it.
Well, that reminds me, can we turn the AC on in this room?
Yeah. Didn't wear the jacket. Yes, sir.
So in a general sense, what's the path for getting some of these questions answered? In other words, is Navigant able to provide research that will answer some of the questions? In other words, methane capture of real interest to the group, what is technically viable? Those are, some probably well-traveled. They're not, you don't need to reinvent the wheel, but there are other questions that groups like this have that do have to have some research.
Absolutely, and this goes back to understanding what the meeting goals per meeting are and what the targets that we're going to be hitting. That, I think that's the importance of having this document for me personally, is because for me, if I look at it and I'm like, okay, great, now I kind of understand, between that July 23rd and the 27th, we're supposed to have that comprehensive list of mitigation strategies for the cost-benefit analysis, so that's where we're going to.
But in this
Absolutely.
Case, there are specific questions from the group that I would imagine would be beneficial to them, the answers by their next meeting. So that's not necessarily within
Certainly.
This existing overview.
Yeah, no, that's a very good point.
So are there resources?
Part of the plan development process, as different committees start coming up with ideas, developing strategies, that's part of Navigant's basically to do the analysis. I mean, it's basically just generating more potential strategies. So it is, they are looking.
I heard more questions coming out of that group than solutions or ideas, and I don't think their questions should have to flow through us to get to the city or Navigant, right?
Yeah.
They should have to, so, but maybe that's not the intent, but have those questions already been passed along?
Navigant was there.
Okay.
Yeah.
So are those questions being worked on, or?
So was there a clear handoff so that you know that there will be a response to the questions at some time before your next meeting?
Yeah.
If they were there in the room, that's nice, but that doesn't tell me that they
checked
the property of
is there something
request. We can go back and watch the video.
Well, I'm just interested in
what
happens.
I'm totally
make sure they understand the expectation.
Exactly.
So, but I couldn't think of that. I wasn't able to go to that waste and consumption meeting, so I wasn't there.
It's a question for every group.
I will say that my experience with that group is that they look to the steering committee as like somehow we are the all moving
bunch.
We're steering. Yeah, that we've got the answer, and this is the bunch.
We're looking at them saying the same thing.
I'm making sure I understand the process. In other words, if what we do is from each report we hear today, we have a list of questions that we know are resonant in those groups. I will turn to Nils and I would say,
is it possible that we can have X, Y, and Z by X, Y, and Z dates?
Yeah.
That's
well,
all
and again...
But with the gathering process, we will start looking at the cost-benefit analysis once we have all of the items.
But then as for...
But I think the other thing we need to be careful with is every question, I mean, there needs to be a resolution to them, absolutely, but it depends on the question. You know, I think it's certain questions are going to be easier to quantify and answer than others. But I think to your point, yes, I mean, that is, you know, navigants there documenting the information, and there is the expectation that they're going to basically report back to the groups as far as what that resolution is, whether it's, yes, this is a great strategy, there's a body of research that we pull forward, or yeah, but, you know, this one, we're not quite sure how this made. I think it's all part of the plan and government process, but to your point, yes, there needs to be that resolution to make sure that we're closing.
Let me echo your comments, because that reports into the national
through the rest of the committee reports, but I will say two things. One, you know, I think, again, the importance of the role of liaison, it's also to provide that clarity, right, to provide that clarity to the working group. So I think, you know, this is very beneficial for us to ask these questions and go through this process so that we can, like, start off on the right foot. I mean, the reality here is that we are just only now beginning to really actually get into the meat and the, you know, only beginning to work. So, with that being said, Mr. Arnott?
Art.
Apologize. Our transportation
you know,
and land use
liaison?
Yeah.
But mine will be very brief.
Okay.
Carlos, I was way impressed.
I had notes.
Yeah, well, I came late to the party.
That's okay.
And what I was going to say is...
Yes,
transportation?
Yeah.
Working group?
Yes. Transportation and land use, right? So what I was going to say is, you know, I'll frame it up. I had a grievance with an employee last week. And when he came in, my HR guy said, these are the things I did as a result of your last conversation. And he said, oh, well, then I have nothing more to speak about. So I had two main concerns. One was the conference call meetings.
Okay, yeah.
The last meeting this group had was a conference call meeting, and it was nothing. It was an hour on the phone, mm-hmm. but there was nothing. Mm-hmm. And I think anybody who was on that call would agree there was very little conversation. Like, not that they weren't afforded opportunity. I'm not criticizing anybody, but there was just no generation of ideas, of thoughts, of questions, nothing. And so I applaud you guys for deciding from the start, you're not going to do that anymore. And I'm glad that we're not going to do it anymore. And then the second thing is...
Have they decided not to? I mean, I don't mean to interrupt.
We are not going to do it anymore.
Okay. So all the transportation is also going to be all unfortunate. This is...
The second thing is that this is extremely helpful because I think the group as a whole kind of there wasn't a frame. So I came in with both of those things on my list, and you took care of them already. So I'm just like the guy with the grievance.
Oh well, hey,
thank you.
If only the whole world visits me. Thank you.
Short
and sweet. I know. I do think that we have a summary document. So I'm going to kind of come back. I'm going to put it on you. For the end, maybe. I know that we do have a summary document of the specific items that the transportation and land use group is working on. So I definitely want us to come back around to that. Maybe when you give Sarah's report, do you have a copy of it on you?
Yeah.
to happen.
I do have a copy on my laptop. I mean, there's not that much more than what
okay.
we just reported.
Okay.
They were all online meetings.
Okay.
All of those meetings were online. It
okay.
was at 1 week where we'd already discussed. We don't
yeah.
really want online meetings anymore, but it was at this time point. Are we going to cancel them all
yeah.
in last minute, or are we going to go with
sure.
We went through, right
what?
Or wrong is another discussion, but
what two things?
There's limited content that came out of it. Like,
I have two things.
What you have, yeah.
Mr. Arndt, that I'm excited about. If you want to go back and talk to the community.
Sure, absolutely.
And we have no other discussion. Two things. One, we're very excited. Recently, I talked to the guys from Tesla about, one, the expansion of their rapid charging distribution system throughout San Antonio. Super exciting. Number two, and that's very tactically necessary, actually, throughout the state they're doing it. And really, we have a whole bunch of it here in San Antonio, New Braunfels, San Marcos, up to Austin, and Bernie. Like, this is the thing that's happening. So, what else is very exciting is that, you know, Tesla has, they're already taking pre-order and about to start production in by 2020 of the new, what do you call them, 18-wheelers that are all electric, the Tesla. And they cost $150,000 a pop. That's pretty much the same price as their traditional one, so this is why they're, you know, San Antonio is as a hub of transportation and distribution throughout Texas.
Sure.
I think it would be really important for us to continue to look at partnering with various electric charging, rapid charging fleet, not just Tesla, but also working with groups like HEB or Whataburger and others that are trucking things at San Antonio and bringing out a way that we can create some type of incentive or something for early adoption of these, of some, I don't want to use a brand name like Tesla, but of a electric transport system. Another thing that I'm super excited about is, if you all read the news about the Texas Triangle. Who heard about the Texas Triangle? It's super exciting, right? So let us not discount that Texas was selected as a handful of top runners, right, in the nation to look at a hyperloop built between Houston, where was it? It's like
Houston, Dallas,
and down here to San Antonio. That will make San Antonio to Austin in 8 minutes. San Antonio to Houston, I think it's 14 minutes. I mean, it's a crazy thing.
Yeah.
What was that?
The hyperloop.
They're building it? Or?
Well, no, that we are like within the
oh.
top 10. Now, you know, we build something like the hyperloop in terms, again, you know, we think about San Antonio. Well, San Antonio is a major transportation distribution hub. So it's not just about like what's, it's also about moving through, what's moving through here is a great opportunity for not only local economic development, but also slashing our transportation emissions probably in half, according to that technology. So those are some things I think that are super exciting and that I would like to learn more about.
Sure.
And I'm
and
not
you know
a
that Houston to Dallas is already a high-speed rail port.
Well, yeah, except
that
what's
yeah.
exciting is that I think the hyperloop technology will leapfrog that technology at a fraction
it's
of the cost.
That's another Tesla, this Musk.
Well, there's two hyperloop competing technologies, two things that are called the hyperloop. So one is and one isn't.
Yeah.
But
they both kind of say the same thing. Pretty
yes.
much. Well, one claiming, you know, it's a Musk thing, Elon Musk, that is. And the other thing is really not the same, but. To my mind, they look the same.
Yeah.
And drawing us back to the technical working group and our emissions, and maybe just a reminder generally that a lot of what we're following up on, like SAT models, right? Sustainability. And a lot of work, the transportation comprehensive document is, how thick is it? And that work is ongoing, right? They're implementing and building and mapping out communities and prioritizing this stuff. Next Wednesday, there's another big, like, SA Tomorrow Transportation, you know, B-session in council. So for the transportation, for our, as we undertake this work,
oh.
it'd be good for the transportation working group or other groups to be tapped into things
right.
as they're moving so we're getting educated and not just be moving
forward. Well, and so that we can, like, be yin yang on that, right? That's a great idea. So, Sammy?
Yes.
I haven't called you doctor. So, Sammy is our liaison to the Energy and Building Institute, so if you'll share with us. I'm sure you have nothing to say about the Energy and Buildings Group. The joke, I know you're
yeah,
very
yeah.
active.
If anything, perhaps one of the most, if I may say so, the most active groups. And so far, there's been
there's a lot of material on the shared drive that we often take a look at. I think the group has done a good job of documenting its meeting and having essentially the outcomes available for the entire, all of the working groups and the steering committee members to have a look at as well. But going specifically to the more recent meetings, and I'm just going to pick on some of the high points covered in the meeting notes. I think Anita has covered some of the administrative matters, which is very common to all the working groups. On the implementation plan side, there's concern about what I'll call success factors, what are the determinants of success in terms of the implementation. And specific comments went towards comparing the step process with the vision verde process, which in the opinions of the commenters, one of them, the step process was a lot more successful because it was ingrained into the CPS energy process with specific dedicated people working on it. And so the question comes down to how can this kind of success be replicated in this CAC implementation? And
can you tell people what the step process is?
The step is CPS Energy's demand side, I call it the demand side management process. It's really I want those who are here to explain a bit more if I'm not covering all the issues. But I see it more as a demand side management process whereby energy efficiency and renewable energy that built into CPS's portfolio. And part of it involves what we've seen in terms of helping essentially avoid the construction of another power plant, which is really, in terms of numbers, CPS is looking to conserve as much as 771 megawatts specifically, 771, which is equivalent to modest sized coal plants through demand management. And that's every time I think of the number 771. So I'll borrow Ola's words. We don't want to build another power plant. So what can we do to reduce the demand?
It's
more of a demand side management effort. And so the key comments regarding implementation pointed at funding, the need for funding and dedicated staff. I think somebody mentioned who's going to implement and the colors and funded and stuff and stuff.
Yeah.
We'll see.
It's a city council.
But I mean, it's very similar. We're seeing comments that are similar across these two committees or maybe even other working groups in terms of how can we ensure or at least in a way ensure success in the implementation of this CAP plan. On the climate projections, again, there were presentations regarding work that's been done by the UTSA team and the scenarios they've looked at, specifically one high emissions and one low emissions scenario. They have specific names, so I won't go into those details, but again, a lot of the information is already available on the shared drive. But the most important thing was they identified certain trends from now going to 2100, that's the end of the century. Temperatures increasing, pretty much similar to what we've seen and heard from the National Climate Assessment as well as the IPCC work. Those who are familiar with the International Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. So some of the actual numbers are available in the reports on the shared drive. But the comments went more towards the data. Most of them, if not all of them, actually had focus on the data inputs into the projections process. For example, why does UTSA insist that it has stopped at the year 2000? I believe there's an answer somewhere in the report. But ultimately, they're looking at those inputs into the projection process and the methodology in particular. I'm going to talk about that very important. The method by which UTSA and the team arrive at those projections.
And that's something that they'll be actually talking about later on.
Yes, it's also going to come up. And then again, on the visions and priorities survey, again, similar to what Carlos mentioned in his main concern was about the underrepresented groups. Again, we saw this in the last steering committee meeting where we actually had a chance to look at the survey results, and we began to ask our questions about why are certain groups not represented, because the surveys are not targeting those groups, and I believe there will be some activities in that regard going forward. There was no specific answer as to how that will happen, but it was looking towards future surveys that will be made available, for example, in Spanish, to reach a certain group of people that obviously would have had challenges reading and understanding the terminology in the survey questions. On the co-benefits, again, this is essentially, as Carlos has reported, nothing specific from this group. But again, the list obviously remains to the list of co-benefits remains to be, it's more of a fluid list that can still be updated as we go forward.
Great.
The next meeting for the group is 26. Of course, in wrapping up the meeting, there were requests for feedback on the implementation plan and the greenhouse gas management, which we will be discussing later. But overall comments centered on the methane component of the inventory, and I think we've talked about this several meetings already. So methane continues to emerge and arise as a very important topic. In terms of timelines, emissions, 10-year, 100-year, things like that. And coming back to the question about the methodology, I said I was going to come back to it. And I also support this comment in the sense that we have a lot of work that's been done by CSA, by other groups that are not present in this meeting. But we see the people, but we'd rather hear from them directly. It's almost like hearing from the horse's mouth. Mm-hmm. Who runs the model? Who crunches the numbers? We may have specific questions for those people. I think it's important that they be here to answer those questions. Navigant can do a little bit, but they're not the ones actually punching the numbers. And sometimes the questions go directly to what's going on in front of the computer or in the laboratory or wherever those numbers, or even the surveys, wherever they're coming from. And I think it's important that the lead researchers and the lead personnel be present to give us, the steering committee, some kind of a briefing on how they went about the process and also to answer some of our questions directly.
Thank you. Yeah, I know we probably have a lot to say here, and I definitely have some comments. I think our challenge, just very quickly, if we can just move to some of the other reports quickly, because it's only 6:00, it's after 6:00 already, and we're on the third agenda, our third agenda item. So can we maybe hit through the next step will be the climate equity from Jessica, she's prepared, and then we can talk through water and natural resources, and then kind of come back around to any of the questions that we may have, but we do need to get through all of the reports and then make sure that we are able to get to our next agenda item. So with that, Sarah, are you prepared to speak about the Water and Natural Resources Committee report?
I am not. I have been on mute. So I'm just trying to get back into everything now.
Oh, yes. No, I'm so sorry. So, yeah, no, that's okay. And I apologize that we're actually prepared to do that. Jessica, are you prepared to do the report on the Climate Equity Working Group? Maybe we'll come back around and maybe, come into the water and natural resources.
Or can I ask maybe just a recommendation or a question? Mm-hmm. When we do these updates, is it possible that the working groups or the liaisons bring equity into their conversation? Like, these technical working groups are supposed to be putting each of these items through an equity lens. Mm-hmm. So when we talk about buildings as power plants or transportation, mass transit, what does that mean? I think each time we talk about carbon, we need to talk about poverty, we need to talk about access, we talk about empowerment, and where that equity is being factored in. So maybe instead of having an equity report and all the other reports.
Yeah, I mean, I would say that I think in my assessment of where the equity committee is, and I tell Louisa, is just working on that definition. You know, what is equity mean for this community and this process? And I think once that's finalized,
then the next step will be, okay, what are those questions that need to be asked through the process? I mean, Eloise, anything to add to where they are?
I think the main points to add is that the challenges around having an online meeting really didn't help us define what that definition was. So the next in-person meeting, with the additional time and everything, will allow us to hopefully hyper-focus on just the definition and start to do the work on the actual assessment tool. You know, what criteria, what things that we're asking you all to also consider. So we expected in the next two work sessions that those will be pretty in-depth work sessions, and we can hopefully provide the definition and start to communicate to you all what things that we're considering and asking you all to consider in terms of equity in your respective books area.
So Greg brings up not even just that specific. Oh, I'm sorry. Hello?
Hi, sorry, just to chime in a little bit about the equity involvement. I remember going through my notes from the first meeting that we thought about having equity working group members within other working group meetings as well as the steering committee meetings. That still seems like a great idea for me to at least continue to consider equity in these conversations. Is that something we nitpicked, or is that something we could still do possibly?
I think it's anything's possible. I mean, I don't think it was strategically mixed. It might have been an idea that came up that Eloise, I think it's something we can talk about and figure out how and seeing if there's interested individuals who want to take on that role.
I think one of the things that I probably want to express is that I think it's been challenging to make sure that all the equity technical working group members attend the actual meetings. Mm-hmm. So having them attend additional meetings, I think that's part of a conversation that particular working group should have, and then make a decision on, and then offer something coming back.
But again, I want to bring kind of come back around to something that kind of reinforced me with your comment, and that is that to, you know, today this is the first time that we're getting what, in my mind, is a very brief, fly-by, quick, in the very beginning report of what's happening, what they're thinking about in the technical working groups. But as we move forward, that reporting of what's happening in those groups becomes bigger and more important, and bigger and more detailed and more important, right? So that, we're just in the beginning of that. So it's really, you know, I look at our liaisons, again, it's a very important role, because really it's about making sure, you know, we're the captains of this deal. We have to make sure that equity, part of this deal here, is that equity is permeated throughout the plan. It should be permeated throughout the plan. So we also, that's also, again, to the role of the liaison. I'm looking to all of you to make sure that we include equity in the conversation, to make sure that, you know, you provide leadership. You know, to make sure when people ask us, where are we in the plan, I think it's part of our responsibility to know where we are in the plan, to know where we find all the documents, and to say, here is where we are.
I think the real helpful thing is, and, you know, and I think the equity work group probably is the most, in my opinion, difficult group, because it's new. You know, it's a difficult conversation, and it's something that communities are trying to figure out. But I think once here's the playbook, it'll really help across the board as far as, okay, these are the questions we should be considering through all our conversations. Without it, it's just still this term that's floating around.
And I think, you know, just kind of to, because we need to move on to the water and natural resources report very quickly here. I mean, don't want us to lose focus of that, but I will say that, you know, these are very important conversations that we're having, and providing that clarity. You know, San Antonio, and I'm, somebody correct me, because I know you guys probably know, so I'm going to just say this. I think that this is true. I think San Antonio is one of, 25 cities that are now beginning to include equity as a part of their climate strategy.
Not even that many.
And I think that we're only the second in Texas. You know, Austin, from what I know, that, you know, they developed their climate plan very early on and then included equity as a part of the implementation afterwards. So again, you know, San Antonio, we're doing something that a few cities are doing, and so I think we have to have, you know, we have some room to grow and to learn, and it's a very exciting for me. But I do want us to move on to the Water and Natural Resources Committee report, because if we, you know, I think it's very important that we hear what that group is thinking about or working on. And again, all of these documents that we have gone over today are also on the shared drive, and I would look to, if you have any additional questions, please go on the shared drive and read them, or please contact your liaison and or myself, and let's have those conversations. So can we talk about the Water and Natural Resources?
So for the Water and Natural Resources, this was also an online meeting, which by design is more one way street than another word, collaborative to me. And we discussed the climate protection. We're going to address it here. There were some questions in that, and we're going to talk about it here the next item anyway. We also talked a little bit again about greenhouse gas emissions and inventory. And I think some of the things that we have heard in the public comment earlier was also mentioned there, hey, we need some time to comment on this and all of that. Those were the key takeaways, and really most of what we discussed there is going to be part of
this next conversation
anyway.
Great.
Excuse me, can I add something about the Water and Natural Resources? I think this is relevant to your talk about the equity being pervasive, but I think it's also very relevant to some of our next steps, and that is the Water and Natural Resources Committee keeps over and over saying, as we talk among ourselves, these are all so interlocked that we really need to make sure that when they start assessing the cost-benefit analysis, that they realize that a lot of these things that we're proposing or we're looking at, focusing on as good tactics, things to be happening, that these have important social value, they have important value to the equity lens, they also have important contributions to other things that we're looking at. So the all those co-benefits, I'm trying really hard to turn this into a diagram when I submit my comments about the co-benefits, because that's really what we're seeing. And so when you see that complexity, you realize that actually a lot of the cost may be very well spent if it's affecting so many different parts of the whole plan.
And that's part of the process.
All right. So let's move on to our item number four, which will be, I guess, you know, Doug is going to be giving us an update status of kind of what's happening.
Yeah, this is just to be super cool. So, again, printed copies, I'm going to be working on that. So I don't necessarily want to dive into the details, but I think I just want to give you a little history as far as where this came from, and sort of the discussions around the methodology.
And I think that this is very important, by the way, because there, to my fellow steering committee members, what Doug is about to talk with us about has been, has come up time and time again, a question from our group. So I think we really need to pay attention to what he's saying or write it down, because this is where we're going to get it from him.
So,
right now.
You know, in terms of methodology, we just didn't pull this out of thin air. We started looking at developing downscale climate projections probably 3 years ago when we were developing the sustainability plan. If you look at the plan, there's a climate appendices, but it's simply looking at historic data from the airport, and then just looking at long-term projections for the region, which basically goes wide, goes up like Ohio or something, from the National Climate Assessment. So we worked with Catherine Hay, who gave us a proposal as far as what the methodology and the approach would look like. And for those that don't know, Catherine Hay is a professor at Texas Tech and basically internationally recognized expert in climate science. Provided input and basically helped write the National Climate Assessment and is a contributor to the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. So we worked with her on that. It didn't pan out. We didn't think we were ready to undertake the downscale climate projections. When we started this process, UTSA has a professor, Dr.
Hakeem Sharif, who has done climate projections before. We hooked them up with Dr. Hayo. They actually know each other, and to make sure that the methodology the professor was using was consistent with the new approach for the updated National Climate Assessment. In addition to that, she also gave us the names of two other professors nationally who are experts in the field, and they took a look at the methodology. So we were, you know, so there's a rationale behind why we chose the selected approach. In terms of the results, those were also reviewed by these two professors, and just to make sure that the results looked reasonable, and you know, the response was that they did. So I think, you know, it's the thing we need to really keep in mind is these are really complex models, we need to also realize that this is about the trend. It's not about any specific weather-related events. So when we look at these projections, you know, my takeaway is that you know the things that we're seeing reported at the national level do seem to be consistent with what we're going to experience here. We looked at the results from Austin's climate projections, which is just up the road. There's a relationship between them. There's some slight differences, but the key is Austin's is a few years old, and is we're using different updated methodology. So, you know, I think more than happy to, you know, basically discuss, you know, questions around this. I think what we're planning on doing is we're compiling questions for Dr. Sharif, so he can at least get a handle on, okay, what are sort of the questions that he's going to need to be prepared to answer. But I just wanted to assure you that, you know, the development of these projections went through a pretty rigorous process to identify the appropriate methodology. But I think that I do agree, you know, having Dr. Sharif, you know, be prepared to provide some responses and justification as far as why we, you know, why the report is what it is.
Please.
Just to be clear, we are working on an FAQ document. There were a number of questions that came, and a lot of them were fairly similar in nature, and the FAQ document is about 90% done.
But I think it was still open for other questions for you guys.
Yeah, that's true, but you will get that, and other people will get that as well.
Alice, when did the FAQ process begin?
I think it basically started from when we started hearing from the different working groups questions started percolating up. So we basically gave UTSA a heads up saying, we're going to, you know, need to tap into you to provide some specific answers.
Yeah. Just to my point earlier, it would be helpful to have that dialogue with Dr. Sherry Shaw, just because some of us may want to look at those projections, the report more closely, and not take, of course, the time of the entire committee, but at least really address some of the high points that may be of importance in the technical context. Also, for the benefit of all the other members who may not carry along with all the technical stuff, we might at least have them understand that for general process and we use at least explain it to their grandchildren, for example.
Yeah, he was out of the country, so we're just trying to coordinate.
Yeah. And I think you know, back to it's you know, helpful you know, we have to kinda understand so that we can explain to others, right? And so you know, I'm really looking forward to that FAQ document, but also just even, and I'll get with you, maybe like, I don't know, three or four, you know, just the synopsis of like, because again, we have to be able to articulate this. So the next person you go to a working group and be like, I have no idea, where did they just make it all up? You know, it's like, well, this is the process. We partnered with an international and national climate scientist, Catherine Hayho, happens to be at Texas Tech. Who she is, she partnered with this man at UTSA, they're going to come, you know, so that we can be able to tell them what the methodology is. So if we could maybe, and again, I'll follow up with you and get a couple of sentences so that we can be able to articulate that and send that out with the FAQ document, I think that would be very helpful so that we can, again, when they ask that question, it's not that there's not an answer, it's just we need to be able to explain what the answer is and what that methodology was. So
those are the kind of questions that are kind of conversations that are very helpful, and just sort of synopsize a little bit on the last 5 minutes of conversation. Mm-hmm. you are still accepting questions that might appear in the FAQ, in the FAQ, when it comes to the methodology involved with that UTSA's projection work. And Dr. Sharif is yet out of the country, but will be returning, so we're...
Yeah, I don't know if he's back yet or not, but yeah, it's on his radar that we're going to want him to be available.
Yeah. So I'm just looking at the concept of more questions or an end to questions. If, you know, I'm not asking for an end of questions timeline. I'm simply saying that to follow the process, it makes sense to gather up whatever other questions there may be.
It'd be good to know beforehand so we can start them.
Yes.
Yeah. To know these are the range of questions that you want me to.
And Doug, when you prep him, if I may suggest to him that, and most of us that do science understand it, if he can use language that the average person can understand and not get too much into, we use 21 different climate models and here's the 5.9 whatever, because I think a lot of people get lost. I mean, if he can just make it...
It's a really complex...
Yeah, if he can just distill it down... It's a good skill that most science people have, so he can...
Yeah, we'll run that. And just to add that, I like the approach of doing the FAQ because, you know, it's good to have all the technical stuff in front. But some of the questions, you have to be very simple questions that can just help the reader understand what they see in the parts of the report. So I do approach the use of the FAQ.
No,
how
can
we get... No, I was just supporting what you said.
Just send them to Lisa.
I've accepted a bunch this week from steering committee members too, coming to the FAQ climate rating framework.
Okay.
Yes, I have another 2 weeks.
Okay.
So,
it's interesting that this.
It's. I mean, the find. It's really interesting. I mean, I think it's. I think one of the big things that we're working with Navigant on and Lindsay is, you know, this is a great document. It's really wonky. Translating it into infographics, something that the average citizen and business can understand, you know, because it has implications. It's when you look at the number of days over 110 degrees, sure, we're looking out a long time. It's gonna impact everyone.
Yeah, I mean, you have to change operations when it goes over a certain temperature.
So look what it, you know, extreme heat does to asphalt, you know,
yeah.
Roads, you know, rail lines.
Build up right up to flood plain areas, and you have a lot of
problems.
It's very common.
And the key is what do we, you know, do with this? You know, I think it's information just to help guide where we need to go. You know, and again, you know, as decisions are being made around budgeting, projects, infrastructure, we should be looking at, okay, what's coming down in the next 50 years.
It would be nice if that measures with the questions that continue to accrue could be made available, because I know every time I see a question, I think at least 30 or 40 more, so I'd like to add those accurately. Just kidding.
And in 2 years, we may have all of them.
Well, I think one of the things I'll just send again is off topic and go really quickly, but just, you know, so we're currently working on basically a new website, but, you know, the current one we have isn't functional. It's just not... We're working with. We're hoping by beginning of, you know, let's say August sometime, of relaunching a much more functional website. And I think one of the things we've been talking about is, you know, having a place on the website where all the questions that have been received through the process live. And so here's the question. Here's the response. So anybody can go on and see. Okay. It's not starting. Because somebody might have the same question that's already been answered.
Just keep in mind that the climate protection, not weather protection, there's a big difference.
So I just want to. We have it's 6:25. We have a break scheduled at 6:45, and our next agenda item is
a potentially longer one. I think I would like to knock it out before we have a break.
I'm sorry?
Maybe there is some ambition to get it done with and have a break.
We should have the break first? All right, Eloisa says we should have the break first. Let's have the break, and then we'll just bundle the greenhouse gas inventory and the greenhouse gas target together.
Just real quick before you guys stop for break, if you need to use the restrooms, I wrote it up there, but it's, you pass the elevators, you go to the second hallway to your left. The first door is the men's restroom, the second door is the ladies. There's also a water fountain there.
How long do you want to do the break? Because I think I'm going to mute for the time. Before
right.
Well, so it's 6:25. Yeah, I mean, originally we didn't have an end on it, so... Well, the intention was really not to just to do a traditional break, but to be able to, like, kind of all talk and, you know, say hi and more socialize. So I would say, like, 15 minutes or so, just so we're not here all night.
Can we eat a cookie?
You can eat a cookie.
Okay, I'm kind of mute here.
All right. So it's 6:26, so...
I mean,
sorry,
Croatia.
Yeah,
just let me
go
know.
Croatia.
Croatia.
I'm so excited about that. I don't know.
All right, so if we are, I hope everyone enjoyed their visit. Back to work. It is 6:50, and I hope that everyone is as excited as I am to move to our next agenda item. If I can find our agenda, just kidding. And we will be discussing our greenhouse gas inventory. And I'm going to let you kick that off. No?
Thank you. Greenhouse gas inventory. I think you've all seen it. We prepared at least draft versions of it several weeks ago. There have been a number of comments, and we've also heard similar comments in the public comments earlier that I want to mention here. There's, I think, three main topics that people ask questions about, and some of them are good for the green community to be aware of. One is about methane. There is different ways of calculating the impact of methane on gas. One has a 100-year impact of it, the other one has a 20-year, which actually is greater than 100-year. And so there's a discussion between the 20-year calculation with the 100-year calculation. The standard that other cities use, for example, New York City, is the 100-year calculation. And they have a footnote in there that talks about 20 years, which is kind of different. That's one issue that is a feedback and question that's been coming up from a number of people. The other one is about industrial emissions and how and if they are accounted for and included. And then the third one is in CPS, is a city-owned utility. How do we deal with the emissions that CPS generates that are actually brought outside the city use? And those are the three main points. There are always questions about it. I don't know if there's any questions here room about it.
And if I could just sort of walk through really briefly and then open it up as far as why the decisions that we're thinking about making. We're following a international protocol called the GPC, the Global Protocol for Community Scale Greenhouse Gas Emission Inventory, and something called the LGOP, the Local Government Operations Protocol. Those are basically the international standards for municipal organizations as well as communities. Now, some folks have said, well, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. We should do what's the right for San Antonio. And I respect that. I think from staff's perspective, it is important that we're using the standard and the best practices. One of the issues that's been going on in this field for years is different cities have been doing it differently. And so when we start talking about greenhouse gas accounting, which is what this is, this isn't just a city of San Antonio issue. This is a worldwide issue. And so it doesn't help when there isn't concurrence in terms of accounting. So that was the first step. And then when we started looking at, well, what were the standard methodologies that were being used? Now, when we look at the GPC, two different pathways. One is, it's called GPC Basic, and then there's GPC Basic Plus. And as we looked at what other cities were using, as we looked at what other international organizations are basically pointing to, such as the Global Covenant of Mayors for Climate and Energy, which Mayor Nirenberg signed on to in January, points to Basic. And the reason why is that Basic Plus includes scope-free emissions. Scope-free emissions are basically all those upstream emissions. What was the energy that went into producing this plastic bottle and to get it transferred here? Extremely important and not insignificant. And recent study by C40 Cities, which is again an international organization, had started working with some cities internationally, and they basically, you know, determined that scope three is huge. It is a big thing. Then we start talking about methane and the 20-year global global warming potential as opposed to the 100-year global warming potential. The GPC calls for 100-year global warming potential. However, 20-year is important. So we have a few suggestions and recommendations as what we're proposing as far as handling some of these things. What Austin and New York City did was they did do an analysis of the difference between 20-year and 100-year, and basically put here's the difference. They actually quantified it. They didn't include it in the inventory because they're following the GPC. In terms of industrial emissions are locally are a Scope 1 emission, but they're tied into the Scope 3 protocol. Well, we recognize that industrial emissions are important. Our proposal is to, something that NADMAT is looking at now is taking a look at how do we quantify, how do we get an idea of what those industrial emissions are locally, and in the plan, basically address it. It's not part of the inventory, but we're saying that industrial emissions are a priority, quantify them as best we can, and basically acknowledge that's something that we're going to have to work towards addressing. When you look at the industrial emissions, the plant was it over 25,000 tons of, I'm trying to remember the threshold for industrial reporting to EPA. 25,000. So, we could capture that. The other thing, when you look at that reporting, there might be double counting, because they're reporting not just their industrial emissions, but they're also reporting their natural gas associated with production. That's already being captured. So I think we're working with NADMAT to figure out how do we quantify that best we can. But I think our concern is we want to make sure the inventory is following that protocol so we can benchmark, but we do recognize that there's these other important issues around methane, industrial emissions. We've been working with Mario on some language around scope 3. We want to make sure that the plan does acknowledge scope 3, and it's something that future updates of the inventory will address as best practices emerge and we have a better understanding of how we undertake it. And I'm just going to mention one more thing and then I'll stop, and then there's a lot to unpack here. The whole idea of the boundary for the greenhouse gas inventory. So we have a municipally owned utility, which is great. When we start looking at the emissions that they're producing, some of those emissions are going to the city of San Antonio proper, and then there's a portion that are going to the grid as well as other jurisdictions. Step one, we look at the local government operation protocol. There's a section that says municipal utilities. My initial assumption going into it was it's a municipally owned utility, therefore that's our responsibility. As you start fleshing out what it actually says, it starts talking about operational control. And so when we do a greenhouse gas inventory and we do the accounting, it's basically, we have to remember this is a City of San Antonio plan, it's not a CPS plan. This is about City of San Antonio, City Council, the people of San Antonio taking responsibility for emissions. And so the protocol says, and it defines what operational control is. So if City Council can basically dictate to CPS what they do, that's operational control. And some utilities are like that. I believe Austin Energy is a department of city government. City Council can direct them what to do. We can't. And so the protocol says, we can't take ownership for those emissions. We can't take ownership for the emissions that basically are going to Alamo Heights, because we can't require them to do anything. So the protocol basically says we pull out what's our responsibility, but we talked with CPS and we basically said, look, at the end of the day, the community's going to want to know what we're doing with those other emissions. They can't just be hid and sort of out of the plan, but I think it's a separate discussion. discussion with, you know, with us and with Steve Guest as far as the goal for those other emissions. But I think there's the concern about taking responsibility for emissions that we're going to set clear targets on that we can't influence. So that's a good summary. And it's sort of the same thing with this, we've been talking about transportation. And transportation is a tough one because the reality is even the transportation that falls within our jurisdiction, it's just daily traffic. I mean, can we really, you know, if somebody's driving from Peoria to, you know, to Juarez, can we really control that? But again, it's best understanding of what's going on within our borders and can we influence that traffic within our borders. I mean, to your point, it comes into the idea of the necessity of regional collaboration and making sure that we are coordinating with surrounding municipalities, with Austin, because this is a bigger regional issue. But at the end of the day, from a local government's perspective, it's all about, okay, what can we influence and what can we control? And like, there's a goal. And I think that's why the protocol is written the way it is. So that's just a quick summary. I'm sure this will open up, but I think that one of the things that we'd love to walk out of here is with some feedback around two critical issues that we've been talking about. One around methane. You know, is the group okay with the approach of, we'll do sort of what the Austin and New York City approach did, where, you know, we're following the protocol for 100-year global warming potential. However, we are doing an analysis and including analysis of the impact and the difference between 20-year and 100-year. And then the other item is around industrial emissions, where we are still, at the best of our ability, quantify those impacts within the city of San Antonio, including a section addressing industrial emissions and scope 3, but they're still separate from the official.
So that we're kind of compliant against this international.
Correct. And so just looking for some feedback as a whole, does that seem reasonable?
I would support the ability to have something comparable across what other cities are doing. And that's why that protocol becomes an important document. It sets the baseline of some kind of a standard for the members to be used.
And one of the things I'll jump in, in this packet you'll see there's the analysis of greenhouse gas emissions per capita for different cities. That's just self-reporting. We can tell you, you know, if it's accurate. You know, because basically it's just everybody's coming into line with GPC.
I was just going to add a few things. The GPC just gives us something, the baseline we can compare and benchmark ourselves against others. So we're not comparing apples to oranges. But I think for those who are interested in the shorter term, having some kind of comparison as a part of the report, I don't know where you want to place it, an appendix or some section of the report that actually looks at what the difference is. It's like any projection you do. In my work, you look at the projection and you say, well, what if things were higher or lower? It's like a sensitivity analysis. Well, I see that.
I think the intent isn't to bury it. I mean, the intent is to, you know, acknowledge it.
So the way I kind of see it very quickly is, you know, that this one specific point is kind of a nice way of still seeing where we can compare apples to apples across this international stage, right? But at the same time, still do kind of like what New York did, which I think was great. If you all has had opportunity to read the New York plan, you might have a chance real quick. But there's a cool, like they, New York was kind of cool because what they did was they were like, all right, I think that they understood the importance of like, yes, we have to do the international standards, so we can all compare everything, but we're not leaving this thing behind, and we're going to acknowledge it, and it's going to be here. So it's there, but it's not a part of the report, so that can still be apples to apples. And I wanted to say, like, for me, not being a climate expert, but it made sense because it was a nice, I mean, I think that, you know, we'll see what other cities are going to continue to do in the future, and maybe more will continue to follow that example, and then that next iteration. The other thing I wanted to say is that as when you were talking, and actually throughout this process, I always think to myself of, we were talking about research earlier and writing research papers. You know, the first thing that you do is you keep a long list of all the things that you're going to write in that last paragraph, right? Like the need for implementation, the need for, we know that eventually scope three will, as that continues to evolve, we need to have, we need to articulate those things. Just because we might not be able to solve everything or break an international model right now doesn't mean that it won't happen. I see the probability of that happening in the future and that we can address those things for the next step, because we have to make sure that we are having a living document, that this is not going to be the end all, that it's going to continue to evolve over time, and so we can provide that direction, if that makes sense.
I want to jump in and make just for some clarification and make sure everyone understands what we're talking about. So first of all, methane and natural gas are the same thing in the way that H2O and water are the same thing, right? So when you drink water out of that bottle that Doug has over there, or if you go to the tap and you get water, it's not pure H2O. It's going to have some chlorine in it, you know, it'll have some minerals in it, but it's essentially water, essentially H2O, anywhere you go. In the same way, natural gas is essentially methane, whenever you get it. And so the reason we're concerned about methane is because it's responsible for about one-fourth of the man-made climate change that we're experiencing today. And the time period is important, whether you look at the impact over 20 years versus the impact over 100 years, because it breaks down quickly. It's extremely potent as the global warming potential as far as trapping heat. But it breaks down very quickly over time, unlike carbon dioxide, which is very stable over time. And so it's important to understand the 20-year time frame versus 100-year time frame in the same way that for policymakers to understand how they look at it and how they make their decisions. In the same way that if you go to buy a car and you want to know what kind of fuel economy am I going to get for this car, you know, you might see the city miles per gallon and the highway miles per gallon, right? And they're going to be different. And so if you were to purchase a car that you're going to use inside the city and you only saw the highway miles per gallon, you might be very disappointed with the results of that car once you buy it. And so in the same way, the 20-year versus the 100-year time frame that you're looking at is very important. Now, the 100-year time frame is the standard that's used in our country and internationally when you compare climate plans. But the scientific community has found that the 20-year time frame is much more useful for policymakers because, for instance, we're going to look at, well, what are our goals going to be in 2040? Well, 2040 is about 20 years away. It's not about 100 years away, right? And so for that reason, ideally, if I'm a policymaker, I think it would make sense for the first thing that you show might be the 20-year time frame. It's good to have the 100-year time frame. We need that to be able to compare apples to apples. So when we go and we show others, and, you know, and we're going to compare, what has San Antonio's contribution been to the international community, and so we can line these all up. That's important to the international community, but if we're going to present this plan to local policymakers, and they're going to look at it and say, what's going on here in San Antonio right now, and what kind of decisions do I need to make right here, right now, in order to have an impact for my community, for the goal that we're setting about 20 years out, I think it's really important to have that prominent. Maybe the first thing they see is that 20-year time frame of the impact from it.
I mean, the one thing I would add, and again, I think we're disregarding, you know, the impact and the need to look at it. I think, again, we need a plan that's defensible. We need a plan that, we can point to the methodology that we adhere to. Because at the end of the day, there's a good possibility that this plan is going to be attacked by those who don't believe it or accept it. And so the ability to say that we are using a standard protocol, in our opinion, is very important.
And I think that's what, just real quick though, that's what I kind of like about the and I'm not saying this is perfect, we can do, you know, a customized for San Antonio, but that's kind of what I like about what New York did, because on page 48, they kind of did both. You know what I mean? So they're like, yeah, we're going to adhere to we understand it, recognize the importance of the international standard, but to your point, we want to know what's up with the 20 years. So that's why they included it as a part of that report. And I think that I really appreciate that, the New York model, not being aware of every plan that's out there. But again, I think it's very important that we I think they set a really good example of how to do both things. That's something that we might want to consider.
Without a doubt, both are important in the same way that city and highway fuel economy is important. I want to make sure everybody understood the situation, first of all, in layman's terms, but then also just make sure that it's going to be prominent somehow, mm-hmm. to make sure that 20-year time frame impact on our climate is prominent, mm-hmm. and so that it's something that the policymakers can't miss.
I think that's the point you're making. It's not a myth or an appendix or some mm-hmm. footnotes. It's got to be, I guess, some kind of a boxed item.
I like how, I mean... Yeah. I think it's ideal, you know, but again, it's like kind of a hybrid. We know that's going to be something, again, that's going to emerge, that's coming. I think it might be, you know, I want to hear from everyone, like, how do they feel about this, but we also might maybe have a show of hands, like, I guess the fundamental question is, how do we deal with that? Yeah.
Well, it sounded like, from your early introduction to this, that the city is not against the 20. Right. I mean, it sounds like you want to do it. Now, I mean, what are the implications of doing that? Now, is it take more time? Is it more money? Is it in the scope of the project? I mean,
well, I don't buy our different strategies.
We're going to change the outcome of our directives.
You know, I think to Mario's point, it might influence decisions related to policy, you know, even in development of this plan around policies and priorities. But it, you know, in terms of additional workload, I think it's just another calculation.
Yeah. I'm not too concerned about the workload because even in a side box, if it's going to be highlighted, it's going to be right there anyway. So the workload isn't going to change significantly. It is just if you look at the inventory that has been shared before, we're just going to be comparing apples to oranges or pole vaulters or whatever you want to call it.
I think it's important to take Doug's recommendation. I mean, I don't even understand what you guys are talking about, to be honest. But there's a lot of stuff that we're, you know, need to still discuss, you know, inside the border, like, you know, like we keep saying. And we could probably have a whole other committee on the methodology, and there's going to, you know, never be a group that really, you know, and everyone's not going to agree. That's why I feel like it's best to take the city's recommendation.
So, as I understand it, you want to use an adopted methodology for benchmarking for comparison to others. But you're recognizing some of the, I'll call them weaknesses in that methodology, mm-hmm. things that are lacking in that methodology, which we heard earlier from the public. And when I read the methodology, first thing I thought is, well, we're keeping so much stuff out, it's possible that we could succeed and still have kids mm-hmm. dropping over from respiratory problems. But that would be absurd. So you have suggested, as I understand it, which is we will do use the adopted methodology, but in recognizing some of the weaknesses, including the 100-year versus the 20-year, including the industrial emissions directly, which that was a big deal when I read it, that you would still go through and quantify it, just that this for that specific purpose. And that's a very, very sound
experiment. And to Mario's point, it's not very. And I think if you look at, and even if New York's sort of even very little, and it's in the back, if you look at Austin reduction, Austin did very issue, as well as industrial emissions, and it's right in the fire.
Jurisdictional boundaries,
we have a degree of being able to influence regulations, incentives, and changing codes. Yes. We want to be able to try to take control of what we can actually try to influence, as opposed to other jurisdictions.
But for the public's perception, our ability to be comparable to other cities, I think, is more important than our ability to have the most aggressive number on what we want to try to achieve, because there are areas that we can't control.
I don't know, if I may, a couple thoughts, and I appreciate, I mean, all the feedback here is great, and I appreciate that, particularly looking forward in terms of having a plan that we can support against kind of detractors or challenge. But, I mean, my suspicion is that challenge is not going to come through the accounting. My suspicion that challenge is going to come through social constructs and the equity lens that we're priding ourselves in on being innovators, right? We're saying we're one of the first, or we're, you know, moving forward on this. I think we also have an opportunity to innovate in terms of the kind of plan and the things we're asking for from the plan. I guess for myself, I don't want to swing past this too quickly, and I do want to call for the, you know, keeping with my email and being in the appointment the way I like to do, for time for discussion, for time for the community to digest this, and hosting that 18th meeting on the 18th for the community to talk about these issues, because I'd like to know more about the industrial contribution, what scope 1, what scope 3. I know cement plants are some of the biggest contributors of greenhouse gases in the city. You know, over 2 million tons, I think, roughly, that I saw on the EPA greenhouse gas inventory website. And I think all together, we're going to snub our nose at over 10 million tons of greenhouse gases in the city. So if we're looking at a plan that in actuality accomplishes the things that we set out to do, that we should be testing the boundaries of what's appropriate. So that quickly, the issue of operational control of CPS, I wonder, you know, we are not Austin. The city council is not the board of directors. We do have the mayor there. But we have the authority to set, you know, to approve rate increases, right? So there is a type of control that we have, and they're coming for a rate increase next year. We're dependent on the income. I mean, it's in the middle territory, right? I'd like to have more time to discuss that. And methane, I support Mario, and I don't know what it'll look like in the report, but it seems like if we're being told that the response we make today in this decade, in terms of crossing that threshold into 2 degrees into global chaos, you know, from warming and resulting climate change, then maybe we should be pushing those boundaries. And I think we need more time to talk specifically on those 3 points. And I'm glad we're having the conversation here. I do want something defensible. I do want something that's strong, but I don't think we're going to be challenged on methodologies and the numbers so much as we are. Well, why are you guys prioritizing, you know, like what I like to say, those least culpable but most vulnerable to the impact of warming in our communities? It's going to be the social, like what Brockhaus said the other day, oh, you're talking about social engineering or something like that, right? I mean, those are the things that we need to be able to respond to and say firmly that, you know, we'll look who has benefited the most over this whole period of, you know, since we fired up the coal plants, and it's been the same people that have the money today, and so we'll talk about those issues. So anyway, that's my entire thing. I don't want to monopolize too much, but I talk a lot. I appreciate that we're able to extend that conversation, and I hope we can stretch it out a little bit.
And just to really quickly report here, in terms of the 18th, we're completely fine with pitching that as a opportunity for people to come together and talk more about the inventory. You know, the idea of extending the deadline to the end of the month. You know, it's not a big deal. I think what we want to be everybody aware of is, again, it's the timeline. You know, and you know, when we look at the greenhouse gas inventory, when we look at the climate, projections, just being cognizant of what our expectations of what the general public's going to actually, are they going to want it? And I think it's providing the opportunity, but I would be surprised if folks really wanted to dig into it. But I think we just need to be cognizant of, how much time, and I just want to say we're all for community engagement and input, and I think to your point, what the community's really going to be interested in, what are these strategies, how is it going to impact me, my willingness to pay. I think that's the big focus, but I just want to make us be aware where we want to prioritize our engagement.
You may be right on that, and I suspect you are in a lot of ways, but I think particularly since we are not operating in a way where we're saying we're bound by Open Meetings Act, and this is the way we have to put things out for public comment, and the way we need to display them, and who we need to reach, that probably beyond this immediate issue, this is an opportunity to talk about best practices in how we handle our documents and our meetings and public records.
I'm back here, but I just want to be very clear that even though it's just the City of San Antonio boundaries and missions that will set the target, at CPS Energy, any strategies we do through the flexible path, that's going to apply to our entire body of emissions. We're not just going to say, oh, we only have to reduce these city boundary emissions. We're still going to do the same things we've always been doing. Our CO2 intensity is going to continue going down, and that's going to apply to that whole time.
Well, that actually goes into my kind of thinking in that if you had a reduction that was required to meet Paris within the city boundaries of X, and that required a reduction globally for CPS Energy emissions of X minus something, how do you treat that? So conceptually, I consider the CPS Energy zone by the city, mm-hmm. and is operated by the city. There is no other jurisdiction that has any input whatsoever on the operations and controls. So while I'll be glad to make the distinction between Austin, city-owned part of their department, I'll be glad to make that distinction. But I think that it is absolutely up to us to think in terms of CPS Energy's emissions as within the emissions inventory. And I know that I've seen the points in the immediate inventory, and I don't know how that functionally would work, but I think that it will be a very careful business. I will be very interested in understanding how those calculations would be made otherwise than a CPS operational area-wide reduction. There's no physical way to do it. So I have thoughts. Let me put it this way. When I saw the draft draft emissions inventory bar charts from Navigant's most recent steering committee presentation, in which there is the 2016 and 2040 business as usual, and the other couple, showing that even with the best of all possible worlds, we still have 41% reduction on the best of all possible worlds to get to Paris. That's the time when I said, wow, if we're going to get to Paris, mm-hmm. and there's plenty of discussion to be had about going beyond Paris, we need end of coal by 2025 and end of carbon by 2030. Now, again, that's very a priority, and I get it, but I'm going to be very interested in arguments and conditions that really represent anything other than a very aggressive schedule, simply for the needs. On the larger picture still, when we look at what this is all about, this is about the abdication by the United States of keeping with Paris. And I don't want to, this is not supposed to be a political conversation as far as who did what, where, and when. The point is that to keep with Paris on a global scale, I don't know how relevant the City of San Antonio's boundaries are. And again, I know, I'm not trying to create more work and greater burden, but when I think of the demands that climate change represents, I'm going to be very antenna up when it comes to conversations that look at less than we can do.
Just quickly, I would suggest if we are going to overlook like these 10 million tons per year CO2 equivalent, then we, in our reporting, that we say the other sectors have to take it up. They got to suck it up from somewhere else. And then maybe that is the thing that prompts other industry, or maybe creates public or political pressure to get it done.
Yeah, I mean, I think that besides we're not, oh, I mean, the key is not overlooking anything. I mean, the key is continuing to track, document, report, work across sectors. I mean, and, you know, Phoebe, you're absolutely right. This is a monumental task. And the other thing I want to say is this is our first plan. It's really important, you know, and I definitely support that. But this, we want to make sure this plan gets done, it's adopted, it sticks, it's implemented. And when you look at cities that have been doing this for a long time, multiple generations of plans. So this isn't our first and only plan. So I think we just want to, and I think this discussion is really important. We want to make sure everybody's aware and understands, you know, what decisions we're making, why we're making them, and what the implications are. But I just want to sort of, you know, assure you that the goal is this thing needs to pass, and it needs to keep the conversation going. But, you know, again, from staff side, and, you know, and Eloise and I, we've been working in this field of climate in cities for a long time. We talk to our peers. I check on Navigant's proposals with other peers that I know, hey, this is what we're doing. Does it sound right? You know, even with the idea of jurisdictional control, you know, just this morning I spoke to Portland's ex-sustainability director, who's now a private consultant, and I just said, hey, this is what we're doing. This is, you know, per the local government operation protocol, this is what we're doing. Is this right? You know, and just because I wanted to make sure, because I know it's a big issue. You know, the response was, yeah, that looks right. So I think from the city's perspective, I think, and I understand wanting to tackle everything, but it's from having a very pragmatic, regimented approach so we can very clearly quantify, justify, and point to the methodology that we're using.
And let me say, I'm also very fine with the idea of, as we've seen the low fruit salad around here, the apple to apple, mm-hmm. That's fine. I'm fine with a protocol that can be compared worldwide. But I just had my antenna very sharply, mm-hmm. as far as what that leaves out and what we should be doing.
Oh, absolutely. And we've had this conversation, CPS and Navigant and the city have talked about, okay, you know, if we're saying this is part of the plan, we need to be clear what's going on with this other piece. You know, it's not mm-hmm. enough just to sort of parse it out. And I think there's going to have to be a robust discussion about what that actually looks like at the end of the day.
I do want to add one other part, which I think is important for this of the steering committee. The mandate that has been given to the city management is a CARES compliant plan. It's not carbon neutral, it's not this or not that, it's a CARES compliant plan, which these various protocols define, whether we like it or not. They have been put in place to have that comparability and all those types of things. So that's what the city is looking at. And yes, there's a few things that are outside of the city jurisdiction, even though they're inside the city. And yes, there's a methane ingestion, and yes, there's also good other things, but the protocols basically fulfill the city mandate of CARES.
And to your point about how we're going to get there, yeah,
I'm
interested also, you know, because you know, we have this is how much carbon there is, this is where we need to go. How are you going to do it?
I don't think Paris compliant is purely a carbon issue, and I think that's
what's
reflected in the framing adaptation part and justice component.
Yep.
I mean, when I read Paris, I mean it's indigenous sovereignty and it's, you know, gender equity. It's a lot of things, and so when we boil it down to carbon, I think it's a disservice to what our mandate really is.
Yeah, and the only reason why we're talking, because we're just talking about this inventory.
Okay.
And a lot of people don't realize that second part of the
right.
Paris
that's
is.
That's what I'm here for.
And one thing I just kind of just very quickly want to add on, you know, when we talk about we would make a grave mistake here in this process if we don't permeate the plan with this one idea as alongside equity, right? It should be permeated throughout the plan. The other thing that should be permeated is that this is generation one, the first generation of this plan, and that we can embed in there our guidelines or recommendations for the second generation of the plan. We were talking about this, like, what city is on what generation of the plan, because Obviously, more information becomes available. The protocol, the international standards and protocol, they evolve, and cities adopt innovate. You know, their standards evolve, and then also technology changes. So, you know, again, kind of like some of the things that have worked in the past have been writing those follow-up plan, like, hey, we will continue to come back and reevaluate and continue to update, or as these things come online, we will continue to integrate them. So, again, I think that that's part of the adaptation, is really thinking about what is our, the evolution of the next generation of this plan. So just because we can't include everything right now, that it's this is not, this should not be the end all. We would be doing San Antonio a disservice if we thought we were just going to write this plan and then walk away and then measure it.
And I also want to add, this is on people's radar nationally. I mean, the fact that San Antonio is developing a climate plan, the fact that it's, we're trying for Paris compliant, there aren't a whole hell of a lot of plans that are doing that. We're including adaptation, we're including equity, we're definitely breaking. You know, this plan, when it's done and adopted, will be a best practice. So it's not, so I don't want you to think that we're just sort of towing the line. This is definitely going to be a good example.
I'm going to get that.
That's right.
Just as I take all this in, I hope I'm not the only one around the table who this is like really Greek to. But just to kind of, yeah, and I think I'm probably, a few of y'all agree with me on that. So just trying to, but then I think here, you know, I'm like, okay, we got us some, you know, Doug, you put some things before us, like we need help, city needs help making some decisions on things. And I sit here thinking through that. A question that I keep asking myself, just to be completely transparent, is how will this decision impact the stakeholders I represent? And a lot of us around the table represent an industry, right? For me, it's real estate industry. And I can't answer that question. Like, I don't, you know, whether we include the 20-year or not, I don't know what the implications of that will be down the road to be able to back up to the people that I represent and say, here's a decision that I made and it did or did not affect you this way. And I don't know if that's a question that we can answer, you know, right now. But so just to further that, absent knowing that answer, I going back to the 20 and the 100, it makes logic sense to me to follow a national, an international standard. And if we want to add a 20-year as something to study, that doesn't sound unreasonable to me. But I say that not knowing what the implications of that will be down the road, but it seems reasonable. And I don't, hopefully some of y'all can appreciate the struggle that I'm having. You know, just
real, that's just accounting practice in all essence, right? In other words, are we including control strategies? That, are we saying, are we observing differences in control strategies that would be applied within 20 or 100 years?
What do you mean control strategies? In terms of strategies that we're going to implement?
Right. Mm-hmm. In other words, is just consideration of the 20-year-old versus the 100-year, does that imply control strategy changes that would be in the final plan?
My view...
That's
going to
put a lot more work.
I'm puzzled also by the fact that we're talking about a plan that will still be followed by the biggest meeting that's today, by an implementation plan that has yet to even be considered,
right?
Let alone who knows whether it will be this committee to work on an implementation plan, there will be another committee that will be steering that process. So to your point, we wouldn't
know
that
you guys.
I don't know, but obviously, I think when we start to look at all these, what are we considering and what are we not considering, I'm trying to make sure that we don't lose track of the things that we are not considering. As we said before, if we're going to have scope 3 as some kind of a laser action, we don't want to lose sight of it. But there are many other things that, you know, the industrial emissions, I hope we're keeping track of this. Even down to the point of, as Peter and I were saying, there are questions that have not yet been answered. Are we keeping track of those? Mm-hmm. So that sometime later on we'll say, oh yes, that was the question we raised 2 weeks ago, here's the answer.
Absolutely.
Or 2 months ago, here's the answer. So there are a lot of things that we have not yet, we may not put in the plan, but we don't want to lose track of them, and we want to make sure that they are documented.
So we can provide them.
Exactly. So that also gives me the impression, what's it going to look like? What's this plan going to look like? You know, how many appendices are we going to have? How many boxes are we going to have? I don't know if we're there yet.
I think I'm wrong. What I'm telling you is the intent is as simple, as clean, as readable, as easily understandable as possible. I mean, there are some plans There's, if you take a look at San Jose, came out with their Paris compliant plan. It looks great, but it's a book like this, and we just don't know how accessible that is going to be. So I think it's making sure that it's something the community can understand. It's 20 or 100.
Well, and I think what we kind of propose is a way to kind of do both, which would be what I'm going to call, like, for lack of a better term, a new work example. So that way it's like we can kind of accomplish both things the way they did. Like, we can follow the international standard and yet still speak to the future, like, hey, this is important to us. We still have the speaking points. And I think that will be, that's kind of a nice way to include both.
And I think in terms of we can work with all of you as far as crafting that language, as far as where it goes, to make sure that it's capturing the intent of what the long-term goal is, to make sure that we don't miss sight of it.
I have a clarification question. There's been some discussion about what is included and what isn't included in CPS Energy, but I want to see if maybe you guys could just do an overview of what it is, just so that it's clear to everybody what is and isn't, before anybody goes further into that discussion.
In terms of what the target's based upon?
In terms of what is included from CPS Energy in the greenhouse gas emissions.
In other words,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's basically. Well, this starts getting into scope 1, scope 2, scope 3 discussion. So, if you look on. I apologize if being so small, I'm trying to save paper. But on this greenhouse gas inventory sheet, on the second page, bottom left, CPS Energy's total 2016 greenhouse gas emissions.
Yeah, pages.
The subheadings, the impact of the several titles, several slides with that name.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's one of the pie chart, as we plan, as they plan ready.
4274 and 7064 in the
right.
And
slide
number
also
looks
for
you. Yeah,
slide.
Right.
So what is
that paragraph that is in the green box? That's kind of the question. That question is the one that I think is the one that amplification of that question, explanation of that statement is what I think would clarify my question.
Sure. So if you could talk a little bit through what the 4,274 is.
Right. So just starting, the blue, of course, is the parts that are the city of San Antonio, and then in that, the orange part, which is about, I'm speaking millions, not tons, so it's like about 4.3 million tons. That's our suburban cities, some unincorporated areas, and wholesale is all included in that. Total.
What's wholesale?
So wholesale would be anything that's sold on the ERCOT market because we're part of
But it's direct electricity and natural gas that is going to those communities. As opposed to
their meters reading.
It's mostly electricity.
Correct.
They pay CPS for those.
Right.
For those products.
As opposed to what's going to within businesses, residences.
In your suburban cities includes Alamo Heights, Castle Hill.
Yeah, there's
31 municipalities and 5 communities.
If you look at slide four shows the difference between the city of San Antonio boundaries.
Right.
And the CPS Energy market by example. That's the same pie chart piece.
And also included in wholesale is our Hondo, Castroville, and Floresville, which are like co-ops that we also provide.
So of those, what is in the greenhouse gas inventory and what is not?
Well, it's all been calculated.
Right.
It's more based upon what the target's going to be.
Right, so the target's going to be set on the 7 million that is in the city of San Antonio boundaries. And then this 4.3 million, it's not like we're going to ignore it. We are still, any reduction measures we take, anything with the flex cap, how that develops, any strategies that come from this group, it's still going to apply to all of our emissions. We're not going to just apply something to the city of San Antonio.
The quantity of application will be based on effectiveness within the city boundary.
Yeah.
So in other words, if the city boundary says we need 20% reduction, that may be a 10 or 15% reduction for your generation. Something. I'm making a percentage.
Yeah. So we are Navigant is going to work with our internal modeling team to develop, once we kind of get some strategies and we prioritize them, they will be modeled and we'll know more about, you know, as we continue through the process, we'll know more about that and be able to explain more in detail. But I just want to make it clear that we're still, so even if there wasn't a climate action and adaptation plan, we're still going to reduce all of our emissions through the flexible path.
Right.
And
you're
so
not going to put controls on one generation source
right.
that are
exactly.
not controlled on another generation.
Yeah.
Well, the only other thing I would say is future inventories are going to be comprehensive inventories like this. You know, we're not just saying that the next inventory just focus on our one little piece. It's going to be a higher CPS generation.
And just so I understand, the justification for doing just the blue 7 million is because the city of San Antonio does not have direct control.
It's you have to basically, it gets back to the idea of the LGOB, local government operations protocol. We talk to attorneys on this. It all comes down to the idea of operational control.
But I thought the target was going to be across all generations, not just factored in.
Not the target. Not the target. The target is within the city, but the application requires overall generation,
right.
which supplies the entire grid, service territory.
Get you to the same place.
The one difference is on the, you know, the strategy level, like demand, you know, demand reduction and transportation. I mean, we're going to have to work with regional partners. So
it was easy, everybody.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't quite.
And also, like with our STEP program, our Safe for Tomorrow Energy Plan, like Dr. Finney mentioned earlier, the city can only make policies for buildings to make their energy, you know, make their energy efficiency improvements that are in their jurisdiction. But we're still going to, our energy efficiency programs are still going to apply to all of our customers.
And
so
if I can comment on that real quick. This number, I called her 1 minute. Thank you for reporting the 11,338 kilotons of CO2 in your entire service area. To keep the scale of that in our transportation, within the city limits alone, is 6,055. So 7,064 within the city limits. We greatly need, because your control strategies that you're going to be doing is going to include the entire service area, which includes folks like me that drive an electric vehicle, not in the city limits, but in CPS Energy customer, and you helping out on that, is outside of that. We have to count for those transportation emissions to match the 11,300 outside that, so you can make decisions. And if we have to navigate, you have to give us the bar graph on transportation to match this. Without it, they can't make decisions.
And so our internal modeling team will be working with Navigant on electric vehicle assumptions also. So that will be down the road as we get into the cost-benefit analysis. That's going to be the next.
I know that this is a very important dialogue, but I just want to draw our attention to it. It is 7:43 right now, and we still have a very important agenda item on, which is item number 7, which will be the greenhouse gas target. So I wanted to just make sure that we have enough time for that discussion.
Is there a way to get like just a really quick, and I know there's more, it's difficult, is it worth trying to get some quick straw man as far as where people,
well, you're talking about 120,
yeah.
or the 100 and the 20.
Yeah, just the proposed.
And the industrial emissions. Those are the two things you asked for feedback.
Yeah. And just to see where, just to get a sense of where people are on
it. I think if there's enough, I mean, it sounds
like. Thank you,
like
gentlemen.
If there's an understanding that the 20-year analysis review, whatever you want to call it, is not going to impact decisions we make with this plan, I would be supportive.
So if you want to put throw in, you know, those that support the idea of staff's proposal for both to make sure that we're addressing it, but we're still following the protocol.
Yeah, and again, still following the protocol means that the 100-year would be reported within
yeah.
the plan.
Yeah, yeah.
Itself.
But we're
right.
still pointing to the 20.
So
let's. So I think I feel like. I guess let's inform. I like voting. That's just me. I like to vote about things. So. Let's just kind of informally show of hands who's
thumbs
in
up.
Favor.
Well, what's the motion?
Okay, well, the informal motion is to take the, I'm going to call it the New York example of
the staff's recommendation.
Oh yes, and we have people on the line as well.
Staff recommendation on the 20-year versus the 100-year.
The 20-year versus the 100-year, as well as the approach for making sure that we're addressing the industrial emissions, as well as scope 3.
Can we do the 20-100-year first?
Yeah, let's separate. Okay. So let's restate what the staff position is on the 120.
So basically what the staff proposes is within the body of the climate plan, having a section dedicated to providing basically an analysis of what the impact is of a 20-year global warming potential as opposed to the 100-year global warming potential, but keeping the actual greenhouse gas inventory using current best practices of 100 years global.
So all in favor? On the line, do we have of the steering committee, do we have a yes or no? I think we only have Sarah on the line, correct?
Diane and I'll just ask for any names.
So I think.
Yes.
So I believe the majority is a yes. So okay. So second.
So the second one relates to industrial emissions, and again, I think it's using the EPA, the EPA database that provides emissions associated with global industry. And so what we propose is, working with Navigant to quantify as best we can what those are, including them in an industrial emissions section of the plan. But again, it's not part of the formal greenhouse gas inventory.
And again, I just need a little help. Is the idea that what is in the formal plan is what are the point sources within the city boundaries? And
yes.
We're talking about industrial sources that are within the CES Energy footprint?
This would be within the city jurisdictional boundaries, because again, it's in our...
So why are they not in? I'm confused on what is and what is not in the industrial.
So why isn't industrial included in the inventory? So basically, again, it comes down to that great conversation we had around methodologies and protocols and the difference between basic and basic plus. And so
it's in scope 3.
It's actually scope 1 emissions.
But scope 1 emissions is tied,
those industrial operation emissions are tied up with scope 3 per the GPC protocol.
See, for me, it's kind of like what we just went through with the 20 and 100. It's like a way of doing it with still following international protocol.
Yeah, but I'm just being specific.
Yeah,
good. Thumbs up.
So I guess let's see a show of hands on supporting that.
Good.
Is that majority? All right. Well, I'm excited that we've made some decisions because we have a lot of them in front of us and we're only now just
I just wanted to thank you. I mean, we're completely committed to, we don't want to, the intent isn't to sweep these things under the rug. I mean, I think it's just more looking at timeline, looking at standards, and just trying to, do what we think is the right approach. So we have that.
Well, and also I think it's exciting because, again, something I'm going to try to remind us every single time, I'm already thinking about what's going to happen with the next plan. And so all of these items that it's like, well, we're following the international protocol, but we want to write in the set and we want to acknowledge it, this is where the next plan begins also. We have to kind of keep that in mind. So I think I think it's important that we move on to the greenhouse gas target.
Maybe the only person other than not to give a thumbs up on any of those proposals, I think offering more time for public comment and dedicating a meeting to this next week really should negate this being considered a vote. I think we should do a canvas the votes after that process, and that in the meantime, that gives all the technical working groups a chance to look at this and discuss this in a setting such as this. And then we can come back and say, well, what did Energy and Buildings say? And not just a representative or liaison to Energy and Buildings. So that's my recommendation. I just want to put it on the record.
One thing I'll say is timeline, the role of the steering committee, to make you know, help make this decision. I mean, it's up to you. It's up to you guys. But yeah, man, I think this is something that's been.
Look,
we've been talking about for 4 or 5 months, and I think you know we need to make sure we get going.
I think we should just bottom line it and treat it like everything else. I mean, because I even will, it's like we make a decision, we're not making a decision. You know, we can't. So I guess in that spirit of all fairness, like I think that's a proposal right there. For me, if Greg wants to restate that proposal, and we can vote right here and right now, if he wants to back off of what we just did or keep going. I mean.
Yeah, I'll just make a motion that considering, whereas we just got this document and opened it for public comment, and none of the technical working groups have been able to wrestle with and ask these questions, we're not the experts necessarily in this room. We have them in those bodies. And so I'm asking for the time to let them examine it, let the public have a better, more time that we discuss. And then we can do it online, you know, take our vote online after we've gathered information from the rest of these of the bodies that are interested to work through these issues. That's my proposal.
I'll propose something else. I'd say that we should give it to them and have this discussion with them. And if they feel it's worth rescinding what we've done, then we should think in terms of rescinding it. But I think that this is very valuable to move forward, right, like this. I think the vote was well met and well taken. And I understand your concern, but I think we should keep moving.
Are they guiding us in a situation like this?
We're supposed to be guiding them.
I think it's time for the steering committee to make a decision and actually steer and direct. And I think we just let it by the vote,
but not before the technical working groups.
I actually, and I'm remembering now that you did say vote, but I kind of stayed with Doug on this being a poll, and just to see where we're at for now. I don't feel comfortable with that being a final decision. I do think that we need, you know, more input from not only other technical working groups, but other people throughout the community. We're hearing here, just at this table, that we don't understand the impact of the decisions that we're making, that what that impact is going to have on our stakeholders, the community, or people that we represent.
I agree. I think it
this is a 60-page document that I'm looking at.
What we've done,
has been, in essence,
to say, are we going to follow international protocols? Yes. Are we going to allow for those items outside of the protocol but are still considered relevant, to sanitary? Yes, we're going to do both. It's not either or, both and. And we have both items in our document. So I don't see what the poll to me is appropriate, because we said we're going to do everything. We're going to do both things. We're just not going to sweep anything under the carpet. We're going to do both things. We're going to make both items relevant and both items prominent in the report. If it's 100 years, if it's industrial emissions, scope 3, we're going to put them in there. We're not putting anything else. I don't see why we need to wait for another public round of
whether or not we're going to follow the protocol.
To me, that's the decision, the steering decision we've made. We're steering that process already by saying we're going to do both and.
And that's why I was comfortable voting.
That's
to your
point. Kind of, that's essentially what we've been saying so far.
I don't disagree with what you're saying, but we're going to have that
public input process.
Yeah.
If we are steering committee members. We represent members of the community. We're going to meet with our various representatives. Groups, and if we're talking about deadlines, we are not bound by that deadline. We here are not bound by that deadline of 18th or whatever. Everything we're doing here would be reported with the deadline of the 31st. So we can still continue to engage with our community, our represented communities, until that deadline, and still bring their input into whatever comments we have on this by the 31st of July. So I don't see why what we've lost yet.
Shouldn't we be voting on the ultimate proposal anymore?
Yeah, I just don't know what the urgency then, in light of that, is to have a vote now if we've got, you know, till the end of the month to receive comment and brief the technical working groups. I feel like this process was designed to have equity, you know, and committee, and then the technical working groups meet, and then steering comes up and steers and makes decisions. We put this document in the hands of the steering committee first, proposed a vote before it's gone through the process that we designed. And that urgency is in direct contradiction to what the mayor just directed us to do.
Well, so...
have seen this in
a long time.
And the issues that we've been talking about, those are the issues that came up from that.
It was a summary of... These are the key items that have
I saw the summary, but not a lot of conversation.
I mean, it was the primary issues were methane, industrial...
And those have been the issues on the table for the past few months. Mm-hmm. So I don't see what's new that's going to come from that process of engaging.
I don't have any answers. I don't have any answers on the industrial scope one, step two, the difference between calcination and combustion for the cement plants or how it quantifies. I don't have like particular technical information. I don't have an answer to how we define operational control as to other cities. I don't have firm on the paper, let me decide. I have this conversation, and that's about it, and a PowerPoint.
But how does that change the vote we've taken? If we eventually have those discussions, how does that change the fact that we've simply said, follow the protocol to the extent we can compare our position and our plan to other plans, and still allow for additional out of scope? That would not change whether we call it public. That would just be a change in the assembly at least.
That it's addressing everything. But we do need to come to some sort of resolution with this. And you know, it's up to you all if you want us to go, you know, because we've heard these very issues. These are the issues that we've heard. You know, and we're trying to accommodate and address them. You know, we feel like we got more time to complete this. We don't have a lot of time to complete this. When you look at what we're trying to accomplish by the end of the year, end of January, every week adds up. And that's, I mean, and I respect your opinion, but just from you know, it's frustrating from my side when we put so much work into developing methodologies, making sure we're using the proper protocols, reaching out to peer cities. And it's just still a question that we don't believe or trust what you're putting forth.
But it came out a month late, and we're supposed to rush, you know, to get back on schedule. It doesn't make any sense.
Well, I think what might help is simply enough if we had access to the emissions input report. In other words, I'm not asking to revisit every calculation, but I think it would be very valuable to have the emissions inventory on which it was based. I'd like to see those numbers too, really. I don't know if that's something to provide. I don't know if that's something that there are.
We can, you know what, we can provide you all the data that you want. You can go download the CERIS tool. You can plug all the information in. The thing is, it's not as easy as that. You know, you need to know what you're doing with the data. But more, you know, if there's absolutely no faith in if there's no faith in the city or Navigant that we have the ability to provide you with legitimate information, that's fine. We'll give you the data.
And that's not my point.
But I'm just, from my perspective, and you know, it just feels that way.
For me, my concern is,
I know, I was going to say, you know, I just want to respect the fact that it is after 8 o'clock right now, and our meeting is officially over, and I feel like we do need to have some kind of closure here over this issue. I felt like we had closure. I feel like it's not. Does anybody else feel that way? I think we need to kind of I need to leave here with what's happening. And I feel like, so I kind of want to hear from the group, and again, we're a few minutes after 8.
Well, I don't really want to have to ever discuss this again. Jerry can be so.
I want to move on.
I think it's a vote of your proposal. Either we do or we don't. We're never going to have consensus.
Excuse me. It seems to me that we're trying to build some credibility up here, right? And so I appreciate that we're following a standard that everyone understands and accepted. And if we're trying to be, we want the community to understand what we're saying, it's got to be in a way that people have done it before. And there's a reason they've done it before because that hopefully works, right? So I think that we've left ourselves enough room, to your point earlier, present other options and to write this in a way that is useful to the community and the council. So I think it's the right solution.
What concerns me is that we are what I heard as reasons for sharing this information a certain way and where to place it and all of that had everything to do with the feasibility or chances that this plan would get approved, right? Which I understand that's a really difficult feat. But if in our calculation, you know, we talked about council, about mayor, about staff, I'm still not hearing what I expected to hear out of this process, which was about how reliant, you know, the feasibility of the plan that we're gonna, you know, ultimately propose is going to rest on the communities of San Antonio, the people most impacted. So that is, I think, something that keeps nagging at me. Fine, we can include it in the, you know, I hear that, yes, we all agree we can include both, but when I hear, you know, we're setting a precedent, people are looking to San Antonio, that's a responsibility, and we need to pass a plan that, you know, our communities will, that we have a responsibility to our communities to pass, not that our, you know, that some communities or certain sectors of certain industries will, you know, get on board with. I totally understand that we need everyone,
but we're still leaving out in way too much conversation and coming out of the Doug and Nils today, I didn't hear enough, you know, reliance on those communities. And that is what is kind of still nagging at me. I mean, you added the word predominantly, that both will be predominantly included. That helps a little bit, but again, I understand that all, you know, supplying all of this information is a whole lot of work. I don't think, you know, anybody working on this is lazy, but we're still not putting enough, when the 60-page document comes out with the idea that public input or public notice is going to happen in 2 weeks, it just really shoots any confidence that I might have in the process, in my participation in this, in the leg. So that's what's eating at me when I'm moving through these moments. And that's why I appreciated a poll strong, just, you know, attempt to then see again, what do other people feel around the technical working groups as they continue to chew on this, as I try to take it, you know, to people I'm working with, and we try to chew on this together and figure it out. Those are my concerns.
And Nita, just as a side comment, I think, Greg, if had we gone with the 20-year as the model based off of like really excellent points on, you know, the, you know, for voting and council members, it seems like, okay, this is more feasible for maybe even getting reelected, that kind of thing. But there's that element of, you know, well, this was a very hybrid, very holistic, and really almost a non-decision, right? I mean, it's kind of like, yeah, let's do everything, you know, and that way it appeases the masses. But at the end of the day, you know, when you deal with international standards, you know, even like with the model food code, you know, there's the federal standard, which is a guideline, but the jurisdictions follow the Texas Food Establishment Rules here in Texas. That's the law. That's the ordinance. And each health department can enforce and go higher level than the others. So I think when we're talking about the 100-year model, it's like what we do with the USDA and FDA national standards. There are guidelines and say, states and cities, you do what you feel is best, but you have to go based on these guidelines. But the state sets the bar. Mm-hmm. So I think that that's where we're doing a similar model here with climate as we do with food, which you can imagine is safety is even more paramount. Yeah. You know, it's like more direct, right? I mean, I can get you right now. So it's one of those situations where I think that we're in a good place. I really feel that you're right. We should get the information earlier. That was brought up at the very beginning of the meeting. Noted. It was granted. And Anita, I think, already, you know, had foreshadowing of the moment of like, we just got this stuff. It reminds me of the congressman posting it on Twitter of, I just got this 10 minutes ago, you know, 300-page document. That happened, I get it, you know, but it is a matter of going, well, let's see if the committees do find that, hey, I don't want to follow the international standard or the hybrid model. Well, that would be unusual that could come from there, but you're right. Had there been any of that, we'd have to come back to the table and say, thank goodness it wasn't an official vote that is non-rescindable, you know, bound by the law, you know, which this wasn't. So, point taken, we should get it earlier. This decision was, I think, you know, one that was very comprehensive of like what New York was doing. That seems like a good model to base things off of. But I think at this point, it looks like, you know, we're in a good place. I think that to move forward with the caveat that, you know, the working groups may come back with some feedback that may have us approach this as an agenda topic again. And for us to just be open about, there was some feedback that changes everything we just fundamentally came up with as a standard.
And maybe marked as a vote on our agenda. I mean, I've talked about my desire to see the process run, that the working groups will respect them and allow them to have this time. I'm saying I've got unanswered questions about how we're actually treating the cement plant that haven't been answered in this meeting. I've got questions about how we're defining operational control with CPS emissions. And I'd like to see that run through the rest of the working groups and trust them to come back with their bet. If they come back with the, hey, you know, this is what we're doing, I appreciate what your comments on methane. I saw Mario raise his hand on that, and I'm comfortable. That's not the one driving me, right? I mean, I would like to see us push boundaries. I understand that the mood is to go with the standards,
But I'm just saying, I have significant unanswered questions that represent a large chunk of greenhouse gas emissions of the city. And that if we don't tackle those, then the other communities are going to have to take it up. I mean, if we're really going to hit that under 2 degrees. And what we haven't addressed is a desire for defining what our process is or something like this. Like, coming in here, I would have liked to see both.
Well, so let me just say, I think what I said was an informal vote. I should never use the word vote again.
Okay.
So, and that was my idea, and I take full responsibility because I feel like I get confused also, and I'm like, okay, great. Let's just see a show of hands, like informally, how people feel, because I always feel like that is the right way to proceed.
And Doug wanted to know what to leave with.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, and the reality is I will say this, I have a lot of faith in our Lindy chair here. If I did not have faith in our consultant and our city staff, all of you, I do believe, you know, that we can all proceed in the orderly fashion here forward and in good faith, and I'm excited to be here. But at the same time, we're the steering committee, and we do have to provide some kind of guidance. So I appreciate everything that you said. I think something we have to think about. And at the same time, we also have to recognize that there's a very fine line between our responsibilities as a steering group and saying things like, or for example, you know, is the general public, is that something like, well, having a vote over should we follow international protocol or not, versus do you want to, I'm going to keep going back to it, swim and fish in the San Antonio River, or do you want all, you know, open up an electric distribution thing? We're going to have to go back out to them, but it's about what is our ask. Right, so that's the thing I think about. So for me, I feel like when I start talking to my parents about this, just very quickly, they're like, okay, so you are debating it's like really, really bad, or it's really, 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 really bad in the future. Like that, yes, that's basically what we're doing, which is very important. But what's more important is that we get to a point where we can begin to, again, we can't lose sight of like the work is just beginning. And so I think that we do, I think in order to continue to move forward, that they, I had faith that this body, that this was something that we can, that's kind of our, you know, do we want to follow international protocol or not? So that's kind of, I guess, the way that I thought about it, in terms of that wasn't necessarily something that the public may know that much about to make it, and that would be like, well, don't you know? Like, you guys are the steering committee, like, don't we make those decisions? That's the way I thought about it.
And the work is just beginning, and we've got people at the table said, hey, I don't really understand this work, but I say that these standards, I trust that, let's go. You know, that to me says that, you know, we do need more time. And I don't mean to say that every issue is going to be like this for me, but this is the document that will inform every decision you make about adaptation and carbon mitigation, you know, going forward. This is that document. And so I don't think it was good to say, you know, I mean, I know this isn't a formal vote. I'm much more comfortable now to say, hey, where's the wind in the room? That's great. But, you know, every document is not made equal. This is a really serious document. This is the Bible going forward. It's like, what does Deuteronomy say about my wool and my linen? And that's how we're going to judge what we do.
So in the spirit, you know, it is 8:13, and
sorry,
we have no. Don't pause it.
And I trust. I mean, I'm not. I don't mean to suggest, and I, you know, I respect, you know, Doug and Nils, and I'm not trying to challenge them on their, you know, their expertise. I'm just saying I don't understand what's happening with the cement kilns, and it's important to me.
You got it. So that being said, it's 8:13. I'm going to just recognize, unfortunately, we did not get through all of our agenda items. I think this is a future goal for me personally. If we can get through one meeting and accomplish everything, that would be a very successful meeting for me. I want to thank you all for your time, and I guess I just kind of want to end it. Do we want to do? I mean, I feel like for me, if we're doing an informal, taking everyone's temperature, informal. All right.
I tested the wind in the room.
Absolutely. All right. Well, great. Well, thank you all for your time, and appreciate your service to the people of San Antonio.
Thank you.
So thank you.